Welcome to the planning board meeting for Monday, January 11th. I'd like to thank Hayden for taking the hearings tonight. That always is helpful for when we have a couple members absent, and then they can review the tapes and participate in the next item if they're continued. And also, HCAM is going out live tonight, so watch out. It's Monday night live. So the agenda today, we've got a couple of hearings. We're going to make some progress on the Leonard Street subdivision off Leonard Street. We have the first hearing for Legacy Farms North, which is a poultry development. We're working on 3440 Hayden Rowe Street, and there are some revisions, relatively minor, to the Marathon Solar project that this board had already approved. So without any further ado, let's start off with the continued public hearing for a subdivision off of Leonard Street. It's three new building lots, and tonight we're expecting to have some discussion. This is, I think, our second time with this one, and we had a site walk before the holidays, and it seems like a long time ago, but it really gets over that far along. So anyway, Doug, do you want to start off?
Mr. Chairman, my name is Doug Resnick, and I represent Rick Barbieri, who's the proponent of the construction of a road on this paper street and the division into three lots. I just, on a point of order, I just sort of like to get an understanding of who's been here, who hasn't been, who saw the tape, who still can see the tape, and so forth. So I was just hoping for a little bit of a roll call so we could figure out who the voting members might be.
Well, right now, myself, John, Claire Wright, Frank, Sebo, who was not here tonight, and my friend together, are all set. Brian and Matt.
Thank you, Brian and Matt. My understanding, Mr. Chairman, just to confirm, is that as long as they're here tonight, if they see the tape afterward, that we're okay and they count as voting members. Thank you. Well, we want to update where we are and some recent communications with Beta. I'm going to let Dave Marcadon and Rick Barbieri actually handle the technical part of this.
Good evening. We've made a few small changes since we last met. With some of the highlights are that we've proposed now a Cape Cod berm on most of the roadway from start to finish. We have indicated a street tree and indicated those on the plan. We've had discussions with Fire Chief Clark on December 30th. He'd much prefer a circular turnaround, which is what we've done on the plan, and to create the turnaround, it's necessary that we remove some of the existing wall on the right-hand side as you drive up. We're going to relocate that wall along the outside part of our new pavement. The turnaround will comply to Town of Hopkinton requirements of 40-foot radius. There was a question earlier about some of our detention basins in the beginning of the project to move them away from the property lines and some screening. We've done both. We have 10 arborvitae planned. It's Rick's intention still to convey those three parcels, A, B, and C, to the neighbors. We're also proposing a fence at the southerly side of parcel number A, a 6-foot high stockade fence. The culverts underneath the road have shifted just a little bit southerly, which gives us only 2 more inches of cover. Previously, we were right at 12 inches. town wells. Previously, we had indicated town water going up the road. We're now back to individual wells. Driveways and the houses remain exactly the same as they were before. Oh, yeah. Yep. On the right-hand side, as we come in the subdivision, on the left-hand side, Elisa Chambeau, house number 3, we have provided a variable width easement that we have. We're going to enter into an agreement with her probably tomorrow. She's here this evening as well. The right side, Alex's property number 5, the pavement currently sits on his private property. That is his driveway. He has no garage. So part of his driveway is that pavement and stone. So if we're reluctant, we do not show a bituminous curbing or berm on that rounding. We're going to leave that as is because it's his front yard. So we do not show an easement on that corner. I think we've been chatting with Andy at Bader. I think he's here as well. And we have a lot of, I think a lot of the concerns have been addressed. Yeah, we're sort of skimming it. Yeah, we're good.
It seems like most of, if I just skim through it, most of it looks like they're pretty well closed. Is that correct, Andy?
That's correct. One of the things I still, I expressed to David earlier, the lack of the easement on that one corner, it looks like it's existing encroachment, and they're proposing to perpetuate that. But again, if it's the town is going to accept this road, you're going to have pavement. That rounding is going to be potentially confusing if it's on private property.
Why don't you talk to the issue?
Yeah, so I think the issue is right now the way that the street ends. It's basically where my driveway is now. So if you were to put a curb or something right there, I would no longer have a driveway or anywhere to park, basically. For that reason, I definitely wouldn't want to.
That also was prevent any very severe arrangement, because you can come down the other street and take a left into the sea road, and you cannot, if you take right, his rounding is just as cold as the left, like, you know, the street for 100 miles of time. And there's no reason for anybody coming out of this street alone and left.
Sure.
Well, on the top, where's
the business? What was the history of the payment that you've got? Is that something that you encourage the people to the town to do when they put it all back together, or is there any history, or how long?
It's always been like that.
It's been there for years.
Like, and when they redid the road, I don't know, maybe 4 years ago, 5 years ago, they just paid it. So it just sort of always been that way. Just sort of following where the gravel ends, it just sort of paved it that way.
That's why the other side is like that as well.
Yeah, I definitely don't want a curb there because then I won't be able to park my car. So, and I think, to be honest, I think there's no need for it. I think it would look silly and it would be very strange if you were to put it outside there. And
keep in mind, coming out of the street, you have a curb as far as you're in.
To that point, Tom, you really trying to keep a soft country look in our developments.
I totally agree with you.
But the point is, if there's a way we can avoid that high look of a granite curve and still meet the need, I think that's more appealing than if we get
the other one. I'm talking about the variable on the road, Joe. I put that there because I didn't want to come in, not, you know, asking for another way to not. You don't want the variable going down the road, too.
A lot of times the berm has been put in a lot of our roads, the Cape Cod berm, which is just the berm.
Keep in mind, we have the stone.
Well, let's take the first one, which is his property. Everyone is okay just leaving it the way it is? be getting to the point where, with the town encroaching on it, maybe Doug will pay.
The voices that are above us are aware of it, are extremely distracted. Yeah. They can't hear anything you're saying.
Or help.
Sorry, I can't hear you.
Yeah, yeah, we'll just.
Hey, you guys.
And we normally have closer to nine members, and this table doesn't work for nine, but we knew we had two outs. So.
It's actually better when you put the plans on the table, you can sit in the other way.
Thanks.
Okay, so basically, where we were, I was just a little concerned that you might be giving the town a constructive easement by allowing it to continue as it is, and if you're okay with that, that's okay too.
That may have happened already.
It may.
But I think no one has the desire to change it.
I understand. I'm just cautioning you. Okay.
Point of clarification, we're just talking about, sorry, I think names are
Alex's
property, Ross from Alicia's property, and the front corner property. And they're both okay with the way it is, and not wanting to have additional stormwater footage. Not put what it means.
Okay, so that one's off the table, and so then the other one is Alicia's one, and I thought I heard that you're going to grant them an easement around off the corner. So.
Yes, I was just
Trying
to give them the indication that
they're
going to grant them an easement today, which I haven't had a chance to go through. But like you said, when we did the walkthrough, it's been there for 18 years. It doesn't really impact me in any way. Try and
change it, you know,
damp
the
drainage site,
etc.
So it really has no impact on me.
Great. Okay. So one thing we didn't hear from this, we really
didn't
see anything happen with that.
Nothing's happened yet.
We're still looking to meet some if they want to do something.
Okay.
Okay, so basically, in the off-site easements, town council, I guess, has said written approvals required from the property owner, so if that deal gets going.
When you continue this one, please bring it in. So, yes, absolutely. We have a letter agreement, and that Alicia's just looking at it. Of course, it also encompasses the things that are the parcel that we're going to occur.
Okay. Okay, let's go to the turnaround. Number of square feet for the turnaround is less than the hammerhead, if I remember correctly.
Pavement wise, slightly less.
So pavement it's a wise, it's a walk.
It's a balance, yep. Yep.
Stormwater, it's a walk.
Yep.
Okay. Unintended. Fire chief is happy with that. Anyone prefer a hammerhead versus the circle?
I
And this is a solid circle, I remember.
Yep, no island, right.
Okay. See, let's put that one to rest then.
I don't know anything else other than what they proposed that should be outstanding other than the name of the street, which I guess we gotta get from the selectmen.
Yeah, that can happen later. Before you record the plan.
Okay. Yes, ma'am, go ahead.
No, that's access to service the basin out in the back.
Oh, okay.
The 10-foot wide gravel driveway.
So that's just like for a service vehicle that would go back.
Correct. Yep. Yep.
And then my other question was, it looks like the land abuts Mr. Terry's land back there. And I was wondering if that land, it shows on that, if it's wetlands or if that's developable land.
Mr. Terry's land?
It's not wet.
I was actually trying to put that together for a couple of years ago, I made a CL plan, and he had told me that he had something 80 years ago, and that's not what I guess. I guess I never walked into it.
Yeah, it went in front of conservation as part of Rick's original proposal. And when the road got longer, had more lots, and then that went away. But that was analyzed by conservation about a year or so ago. And that's high and dry.
So then my follow-up is just that that seems like a perfect entry then for Rick Barberi to go into that Tom Terry's land and continue building in that direction.
Well, he's got a problem in that we wouldn't allow that he's dead end on top of a long dead end. He has these three lots because the road was a paper road. So we're just improving the increase of the type of paving, et cetera, to bring the road into the regular spot. So
against the
policy of the board to go that way unless we somehow got a second way of getting in and out. Now, if you could take the Terry land and get around, you know, complete a loop, yes. But
that isn't close to the board.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
The second access point for the school, would that then enable more building on Thomas Terry? I'm sorry, I don't know what's wrong. Mr. Terry's land.
Possibly.
And that's something that everybody seems to be in agreement that you
can say. Oh, no. That connects with the school. It's not a road. That's true. That's just going to change reasons to access. That's not what Tom Terry gave me. That's not my own
right.
Use. That's only
the
school. That's not
the help
on Terry's driver's access. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So, Mr. Chairman, there is a spit of land in between Alex and George. Is that considered a paper road? And if so, would that in the future come into question as a second entrance into Mr. Terry's land?
I don't think that was that wide, was it?
Well, this one entrance, but would that allow the loop to take place?
I don't think so, because I think it'd be too long. And the gentleman in the back.
Ted Barker, 75 Boroughs. On that same Terry land, I don't know what the rules are. What if there were just long driveways that allowed access? There was room in the development, I believe, to put in some driveways that are not quite lots.
We require frontage.
I'll put it on the deed if it doesn't. There's no driveways.
Correct.
There will be.
to answer the question, there's no paper street in our research. There was no suggestion of a paper street going across the territory.
Sure, go ahead.
From Leonard through McDonald, yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Yes. No, no.
So, yes. That means that Mr. Barry Lindlock.
I'll skip it.
We have we're talking about driving on this property here. Secondly, stipulation,
Oh, you don't have to find it anywhere. Yeah. I agree. Okay.
Can I just get clear? So the answer was it's impossible to develop that land with the one road?
I won't say everything is impossible, but this board doesn't have the authority to do it. Maybe the Board of Appeals could. I don't know.
In our title, Mr. Chairman, we don't feel that anything involving Mr. Terry's ability to develop that land, unless in the prior case it was connected to this, which the board is.
I'm wondering if we should get approval substitute to the generous music.
No, we only need five for this vote or six?
Town Council said it has to be in writing. The easement has to be in writing.
Okay.
It's not in writing yet.
What I'm seeing is, and let me ask the members of the board, do you see any objection on the technical aspect of building up the road that's here and data comments per se? I think we've got everything pretty well set.
I did have one question.
Go ahead.
Number H talks about the base and approximately 10 feet from the property line. The applicant shall relocate the base and comply with the setback requirements. I know it was done. I guess my question is, I guess just because of the way the topography tends to slope off the backside there, what if that catch basin isn't sufficient or adequate and you've got a higher degree of runoff that goes into some of the buddy neighbors' property?
But that's a small one, the big basin. It goes into that small basin on that northern end and then goes out to the back basin.
For the basins, or you're
showing the limits of clearing as well as the basin indicates. Okay, here's the basin further west.
Yeah, and further north.
And now we move the sections. This skip towards the wall here.
And then the comment for the looking at is
is there any recourse? Let's say the design looks great now on paper. Let's say after year one or what have you, it is not performing as designed.
Sure.
Is there any recourse?
So this is all
flagged. This is not.
It's still fine. It's not all easy. This is all easy, so we have every ability to expand on that. So the type of having sent the capital credit card you want to do that.
Is that a comment to general comment number three? Is that what you're referring to, or just in general?
I was just in general. I was going off eight, but I think there's a lot of spiders that we can kind of take down that route, but they clearly addressed it, and it's addressed the concern about it, you know, why the homeowners feel like there's some issues they can do.
Yep.
Sorry, what was the response to your question as to is there recourse should someone like myself who has no water in our basement all of a sudden gets water?
Right, and that's...
Well, this was across the street on the other side of the road.
Okay,
Between the right side of the road as you drive up and Tom Terry's property. We have a small basin near that existing garage that Alex is going to get.
Yep.
And previously it was more in the corner, and now it gets slid out away towards the road, away from private property. So the question came about is if it ends up being too small, do we have the ability to expand on that? And I said, yes, there is. We have room to expand on that.
The real thing is the pipe is... Fix the overflow from that basin inside directly, and if it is, it's causing it to the other spot. Claire?
Well, to that point, and again, we're disadvantaged because we're just trying to read this right now, but I did notice that Beta had asked about roof infiltration, and that the response was that the recharge volume is present in the applicant has indicated that the recharge volume is present in the retention basin and the high groundwater makes individual infiltration units difficult. So they're saying that the basin can handle it and can't infiltrate the individual roof units. And then also, Beta had asked about a mounting analysis to verify that the basins will function as designed. So we're being asked to assume that the basin is adequate to do the roof runoff because what Beta is asking for is not feasible. So to Alicia's point, do we need to have that mounding analysis to give us additional certification that this...
I think the mounding was done. In the original calculation, the basins, both of them, on the right and in the back, took into account the driveways and the rooftops that went all the way back into the pond. Andy asked if we could recharge on top of that and do it at the house. And we had high groundwater near the house, so instead of elevating everything, we wanted not to do that and put everything down to the basin. Recharge, not storage capacity, recharge, putting it back into the ground at the exact same location.
Beta was still asking for a mounting analysis, and I don't know if it's indicated as... Oh, wait a minute, maybe it's just that Beta recommends mounting analysis provided to verify.
Did you?
The one that I don't see closed.
SW4. I still don't see any response that has been addressed. You're saying it's been done, but nothing from Beta says that it's been done.
Yeah, I know that it's been done, but I guess it didn't get to Andy, so I guess we'll...
Just to clarify, I asked about the roof runoff because it generally you like to try and keep the roof runoff separate because it's considered clean. Mixing it with the driveway and the street drainage, it then gets treated by the clarification systems, and it adds more water to those systems than necessarily has to be there. So if you can treat it ahead of time and infiltrate it separately, it makes things run a little smoother. They have high groundwater near the physical house lots, making that difficult. They've added the extra volume to their stormwater system to account for it. It should work just fine. It was just trying to add a level of factor of safety, if you would.
Right. So I understand you're saying you're good with not having roof infiltration.
Yep.
My question is, your letter that we received tonight still does not say that Beta has received the mounting analysis that proves the basins will function as designed. And
I still haven't seen the mounting analysis.
Okay. So that is still
on. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Very quickly, our agreement with Alicia covers a couple of other things besides the easement and corner. And some of them are not, one of them course, is deed where the parcel's parcel A. The article of two other tenants lend themselves to the deed or easement. Will the board accept as an agreement an agreement to do all these, to do all the grants with deed?
Well, it's going to be public record. That's probably an easement town meeting will have to accept.
When the town accepts the road as a public way, but not until then.
Okay. So
we'll work on that. We'll need the other documents to come very quickly thereafter.
Okay. I think we've got Claire. Go ahead.
Yeah, I have two more things. David had a question about height. The 18-inch HDP cover that had the amount of cover over it, and they had noted that the amount of cover provided is the bare minimum, and they did not feel comfortable not having a little extra for safety, and that has not been addressed, at least in Dave's letter. It sounds like you're at the minimum, but our engineers were so comfortable with it anymore. What's where you go on that?
Yeah, we relocated it just a little bit, but we're only able to pick up 2 inches of cover. So we went from 12 inches to 14 inches.
And I would say that it's not ideal, but it meets the manufacturer's stated minimum standard.
One other
thing. Similar question. If you had a different material for the culvert, concrete pipe,
we could put concrete on top of it.
Yeah, that's true. They could do that. I'd probably rather you have a concrete pipe than a concrete encased, though.
Okay.
But they could use a high-strength concrete. That would solve some of the issue. The only issue with that then becomes you'll probably see a reflective crack across the top of it because it creates a hard point. So you'll see a crack develop after a few years.
12 inches is the minimum, right?
Yep.
12 inches? 12
inches is manufacturer's minimum, you're providing 14. So you're at the manufacturer's minimum. Just, it doesn't leave a lot of room for error, that's all.
Do we care one way or the other, as long as the engineers, this is...
I think it's probably okay. I would also add, I haven't spoken to your DPW director. He may have an opinion on that as well. If the town accepts the road, it's going to have to be him. His order is going to have to maintain it. So,
go ahead, Claire.
Yeah, one more thing. There is now a landscaping plan, but apparently it is strictly inclusive dogwoods, and Beta has pointed out, and we usually concur, that you don't want to do all of the species on it. So there's some infestation comes in by wild trees. Based on what we usually look for and what Beta has recommended, I would look for you to mix in some species rather than all at once.
I was actually looking at small ones, so you can figure out where it is. But I didn't see it when it
looked changed. Yeah, just mix
it up. Maybe something else with flowers similar.
Yeah,
I like the flowering trees. One of the former tree wardens was got me in the hall and said, "Someone stop putting all those swamp maples and put flowering trees."
Just dump my eyes in the basket. Yes.
Your opening comments, you talked about changing the parcels from the town water to the well.
Correct.
What's the rationale?
Right now, there's only too much pipe coming down the street for us. We tried to change that this past law, which
Board of Health will approve the well after it's tested or after it's done drilled. Assumption is that you can find water. Yes,
a question on that same, the reason to go with wells versus the town water, because I know when 6 Leonard Street, when we connected into the town sewer,
and the pipe actually broke on Leonard Street, and DPW came out to fix it, just that section of it, and they looked at it and said, this pipe is horrible, we could only patch this piece if it was a wider pipe, which you would have better water pressure. So I think it would have been nice if that could have happened, that the water that we could have, those new homes could have connected into the town water and not wells, and that would have helped the water pressure on the street. Yes.
Yeah, and I think you tried to work out something with the water department, and obviously we didn't get caught.
It's the water pressure is bad.
Start talking to the water department and tell them that
why not?
That's
not
the question.
Sure.
Why did it fall through?
Why?
Is it a money issue?
Well, it was hot money, but it was just kind of funded before it was different. Also, I wasn't busy. I don't know if I was there was a way of some things that they found were good, and there were ways of some woods and water. So, and they kind of helped me.
It seems like everyone would benefit if they had
everybody.
My question is, let me get
more expensive to run the pipe down your line.
That's the issue. But I mean, you know,
I offered it down $25,000. They were going to pipe down it. They know that they're trying to put out the bid for film rate across the board. So they asked me to do it, but you're still doing it.
So do we have any recourse
to the DPW? I would talk to the DPW as citizens and the selectmen who oversee them and say there's a problem here. And
let's find a solution.
They're the ones that are providing the service. Yeah, I was water commissioners.
This is kind of a recurring theme that I've been learning over the past year, where we have other town departments and other committees that we work with or interact with or have something to do with on a project like this. And we were out there in December, and it was a very nice warm day. It's been a long time ago, but it was like 7 degrees. We were talking about this, and now it's a couple weeks later, and we don't actually have specific information from anyone. We have, they told you this, they told us this, they told the neighbors one thing, and we don't specifically have an answer in black and white that says this is the case. And I don't know where that gap in the communication is, and whose responsibility is to fill it. The neighbors have a need, the developer has a need, and we're trying to get all the pieces together. So
the authorities with the water department.
Sometimes my recent deals with DPW have been best described as screwed up. They don't answer, you have questions, you wait weeks for answers.
I had a very good relationship. It almost happened. They tried.
I have a good relationship with them too, but I don't know what is the proper channel to get this kind of information, this kind of communication happening with them. It's a little bit hard also to come in, you know, 5 minutes before a meeting. I've only got one out of three or four packets there. We have all this other packets that we get mailed, so we're trying to keep up with a lot of information, but we don't have the most hard response from the DPW and the water department. And maybe it was it different when we had elected board in charge of DPW? I don't know.
That's the point.
Sure. I don't want to bash another
board here either.
I'm not bashing. Just trying to, what do we do? How do we?
It was a business decision that was made, right? It's a business plan he's trying to get done. You're actually trying to make overture back to the school and water department. If you go anywhere, he's moving forward. The solution they put in place. I would opine to the abutters and to reach out to the selectmen and to try to get something to happen behind the scenes. We can't do anything. Right.
So what do we do as abutters?
Well, basically you've got a service issue.
Right.
And complain as a customer.
You need to speak to the DPW and the board of selectmen. See if they can get something moving.
So will those three new homeowners in those nice new homes.
Well, they're going to have their own well water. Brings its own set of issues, potentially. Okay, I think we're all set.
Just to look at for taking the Wayne's memo today, she referenced the fact that our time was running out. So I prepared a request for an extension of the public hearing and a request for returning to the board to make this decision. And I just want to fill out a few minutes here.
Okay. What do we recommend?
Next meeting?
January 25th.
So give us a few more days beyond the 25th.
Well, usually 2 weeks, I think, is what the year typically requests. And what would that be?
Did you pull up a calendar?
Have a cake.
It's February 8th.
Thank you. Do we need a motion to accept that?
Yes, and to grant the extension of time.
Motion to grant the extension to February 8th?
Yes.
Second.
Thank you.
You're okay?
Yep.
Okay, so you have a motion for us to grant an extension to the 8th. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, in favor, carried.
Thank you.
You're on the agenda here for Hayden Place, I believe.
I just have a question about, maybe it's not, I'm trying to follow the public meeting outline.
Yeah.
The extension, are we done with this outline? I don't know if we got to the public comment part at the very bottom. Would that be on January 25th?
Yes.
Or
yes.
Is that other business that's happening on January 25th?
No, that'll continue there.
So we're still living on this outline?
Yeah, we're through the technical aspect at this point. And so we need a motion to continue the public hearing to the 25th of January. At what time, Elaine?
8:30.
At 8:30.
Including public comment.
Yes.
And anyone is also encouraged to send a letter if you want it formalized, too.
Great. Thank you.
So,
I heard January 25th and I heard February
8th. January 25th is the meeting, and then we have that time to write the decision.
Okay, thank you.
So, okay, there's a motion on the table to continue the public hearing to the 25th.
I was just wondering how many people wanted to speak here tonight, came here expecting to speak.
What's the question, Frank?
How many people came here tonight expecting to speak on this topic? We have less than 5 minutes to left in this portion. If there's only one person, how do you open here what he has to say?
Do you want to do it today? Yeah. Let's
up to you. I'm looking at the clock. I don't want to throw off.
Go ahead. Let's do it.
Thank you.
So, thank you. Ted Barker, Hook, 75 Grove Street. I just want to speak in general against the entire development. I know that there's a paper road, and I know that there are some rights there. When I list for myself the pros to the neighborhood versus the cons to the neighborhood of this development, the pros to the town, the center of town versus the cons, the balance is heavy on the con side, and let me just offer a couple. The street's narrow. I know that we're approving 36 feet, but there are a couple houses with some families where they're going to have parties, where they're going to have gatherings, and we're going to get street parking on that street. And that kind of easement scares me. I know that if, according to the lawyer language, you have to apply the current subdivision regulations to the greatest practical. Well, there's room on the other side of that stone wall to make a road wider, perhaps. Maybe not with Alex's house. But that scares me anyway. We can't make it longer. That scares me. I worry about, in this case, it's, I don't know, 9 or 10 more kids to our school system. In addition to the Hayden Road development. In addition to the Davenport development. In addition to Legacy Farms. Our schools are bursting at the seams, and some have said that the new plan for the replacement of the center school is already too small. based on other projections. Here we're adding just more children. These are going to be homes that are family homes. These are not retirement homes. If we have houses of this size, it's probably families with a minimum of two cars, growing teenage driver, three cars. That's an addition of 9-10 cars on this teeny little street. Exiting to a corner, I live right around the corner from the corner of Rowe and Pleasant, where we have accidents with regularity. We just had a pretty hairy one the other night. The way Leonard Street comes out, where all of the people coming out of Easy Street, I know it's not really called Easy Street, they're also coming out of Leonard right next to an intersection that is not entirely safe. We're adding safety concerns to the neighborhood. Beyond that, I worry, I know that we have the catch basins. Right now, rainfall falls on an open field and goes straight to the ground. The moment we put houses and roofs and lawns and chemical fertilizer and roads and driveways with salt, that's a whole lot of runoff that may or may not be caught by our catch basins. It may also just run right down the road. And if you come out of Mr. Barbier's development and turn left, it's soaking wet through all of those homes. And that's exactly where the land is sloping. I can see water not being caught by a catch basin, coming down onto Leonard and taking a sharp left, because that's the way the earth will direct it. That's a lot of fertilizer, that's a lot of salt, that's a lot of sand, that's a lot of junk going into wetlands. And that scares me a little bit. And as long as I can't find a positive for our town, I hope that when the board considers the greatest extent practicable to holding us to subdivision laws, we consider what's good for the neighborhood, what's good for the town, and what does this mean greatest practicable extent.
Anyone else want to comment on the public up? Yes, ma'am. Go ahead.
Jennifer Andrews, 74 Grove. I just want to concur with everything that Jeff said.
Denise Mayer, 6 Leonard Street. My home will be facing that Maple Grove, so for me, I'm opposed to it. It adds no value, and I absolutely agree with Ted Barker.
Okay, I think now we're ready for a motion to continue. The public hearing until the 25th of January. Move. Second. Further discussion to vote aye.
Aye.
Carries.
Okay.
Yes, so we'll do that real quick here.
Thank
you. Thank you. Ready for a
bond. All work has been
done. It's like 12.
There's some
lane. It's a fairly private way. All the work has been done. Looking to release a bond of $18,001.26.
So moved.
Second.
Vote
aye.
And we'll vote in the schedule of the chair. Thank you. Yeah.
I know. I just somehow maybe it's on my soft couch when I was reading it. So I thought. Thank you. Okay. You guys ready? Okay, we're going to open the public hearing. This is the Northeast, Northwest, and Club North Villages of Legacy Farms. It's an application for OSMID site plan review and amendment to the master, to the Legacy Farms Master Plan Special Permit, proposed by Pulte Homes of New England and Legacy Farms LLC. This is a proposed development of 425 housing units and also adds 37.5 acres of restricted land at Legacy Farms and is an amendment to the master plan building area. For this project, we have instituted a kind of a public hearing line. I think everyone expects this to take multiple meetings so that we kind of keep on track and not jump all over the place. We're going to try that public hearing outline. We'll hopefully get through setting the outline today in the next hour and discussion, so it's the first maybe three, and maybe we'll get into the general discussion depending on how we go for this the next hour. But this project, being as large as it is going to take more than one meeting. Also, by having the general discussion area, we're going to talk about a lot of issues, which would then allow the applicant in between the meetings to update plans and move along as we go through there. So there's a lot of general type stuff in that section, and then we'll nail down to it. I also asked our beta folks just to look at engineering on one of the proposed villages in detail so that we'd have enough if we flew through something, but I didn't want them to spend a lot of time on the other two until we had a lot of more of the general discussion, because I wouldn't want them to have to review stuff that might get changed in that area. So basically at this point, kind of having explained the outline, basically we'll start off with a brief review of the overall design and stuff from our Director of Land Use Planning and Permitting, Elaine.
All right. So I thought I'd just give a general overview of the structure of the regulatory framework and where we are and kind of how we got here. So what we've got on the screen is the original Legacy Farms Master Plan that the Planning Board approved in 2010. And when it approved that master plan, it approved the master plan special permit and attached this plan and other documents as well. And this is the umbrella that covers the whole site and provides the conceptual framework for how it was going to be built out over a period of 10 to 15 years. And once we approve that master plan, the board goes through the various procedures to get to plan approval. So under the OSMUD overlay zoning district, the board has approved the special permit with those attachments, the host community agreement, the design guidelines, which factor into the design of the site. The well agreement, the restricted land covenant forms, intersection improvements. In tandem, it's also been approving subdivision plans for the major roadway going through the site, the north and the south. As development plans go forward, it approves the restricted land covenants. Those get recorded in the Registry of Deeds. And each site plan comes under that master plan special permit. So when they're ready for the detailed design, the site plans are submitted. They're fully designed for construction purposes. And this is the fifth of those site plans with the south side going first. And this is the first one on the north side. So one of the major components of the OSMUD district is the design principles under which the site plans are designed, and it looks at not only the built areas but also the preserved areas, because in all of Legacy Farms there's 733 acres, 500 acres of which will be open land. So the development is actually on a small portion of the site, although going through it may seem large, it's really a small land area compared to the whole site. So these are the design principles that are in the zoning bylaw, and they're further expanded upon in those design guidelines that the board drafted, worked with the master developer on, and ultimately approved. It guides the development of this property. And so it talks about fitting things into the land, the design of trail systems, being respectful of existing neighborhood settings. And so in Legacy Farms, there's two categories of land, and there's either buildable area or restricted land. And so the board's familiar with restricted land and seeing the covenants. And land that's restricted can be used for active and passive recreation, for conservation, for forestry, agriculture, for buffers, underground utilities, municipal purposes, and anything else that's necessary for the convenience and enjoyment of the district or the town, is the way that the zoning bylaw puts that. And it's supposed to be provided along with the development, so it doesn't all wait till the end. So it's provided in pieces along with the development as it occurs at a ratio that the bylaw requires. And then as far as a road and pedestrian network, for the north side, this is what was approved in the original master plan. This was the north side, and it showed the restricted land types. It showed the conceptual layout of how it might be developed. And as far as a road network, the original intent was to have one long spine road through the whole property with the small private ways coming off that. And the design guidelines contain the standards for those roadways. The pedestrian network consists of the wide pedestrian and bicycle path that parallels the roadway. So that's for both pedestrians and for bicycles. The smaller sidewalks in each of the villages, and then the overall trail network that's going to be in the restricted land. And one of the things that the planning board did was delegate the conception of the planning of that trail network to the Open Space Preservation Commission. So that still is a process that's ongoing and needs to be furthered, you know, as this goes forward. And then the buildable area is basically anything that's not restricted land. So there's only the two categories that we have there. So I just wanted to give that brief overview. And do you plan to use the plans that you had submitted, or are you? Okay, so I should bring up your.
Mr. Chairman, board members, before John and his team start with the presentation that they prepared, I just figured I'd come up here and introduce myself and the members of our team who's before you tonight for the site plan application and the special permit amendment. My name's Mark Mastriani. I'm with Pulte Homes of New England, so we're the applicant behind the proposal, and I'm here with Reed Blue as well from my office. And just wanted to say that, you know, we're excited to have the opportunity to continue building at Legacy Farms. I know I speak for myself and Reed. I think we've worked hard over the years to develop a working relationship with the town, and we look forward to continuing that relationship for years to come. With us tonight to help us give the board a presentation of our proposal is John Cusick and Nathan Mahoen of Bowler Engineering. So they're the civil engineers. They're really the team and behind the design and the plans that were submitted in the application. And we also have Matthew Merva of Bowler Engineering as well. He's their director of landscaping, and he's really working with us and our team on the site planning and the landscaping and the landscape architecture of our design. So I think he'll be an instrumental piece of our project team. And of course, we have Roy McDowell here tonight. You know, Pulte Homes, we work closely with the master developer with all of the global issues of Legacy Farms in general. So I don't want to take up too much time. So with that, John, I'll pass it over to you, but just wanted to introduce myself to the board and to the members of the audience.
Okay. Thanks, Mark. For the record, John Cusick with Bowler Engineering. What I'd generally like to do is just very briefly go over some of the project history, the permits that are needed, the overall site plan for the project, at which point I will turn it over to Matt, who will get into more of the details of the landscape concept as well as the amenities of the project, and really dive into the overviews of the three villages. So, again, this project's been before the board for many years. I think it was originally, special permit was originally issued back in 2010. Since that time, you've seen multiple filings for the project as it's come through, mainly on the south side of the development. What we're here before you today is actually for the north side of the development. That's actually shown here. This was the original plans that were prepared for the project. It developed essentially a buildable area, which came up with approximately 425 allowable units on this area over here, which is about 89.1 acres. That's the area highlighted in yellow, just to orientate you that this is just the north side. North is up. This here is the spine road coming here. So you had one development on this side of the road and another on the other side of the road. Again, you'll notice the yellow is the buildable area that was approved, about 89.1 acres. It extended right up to the limits of the roadway on either side and extended back pretty far into the site. There's some wetland areas back in here, and over here as well. So it did use that portion of the site. So maybe go to the overall plan. So the project permits for this particular project, we're going to need obviously site plan approval and through this board. That is to show the overall development that is proposed. Yep, right there, Nate. Additionally, we're going to need a special permit to the planning board. That is to essentially modify the buildable areas that are on the property. As I mentioned, there is currently 89.1 buildable acres. That's in the master plan special permit. By way of this development, we're going to be modifying that and actually reducing the size of the buildable areas down to 74.5 acres. We will need a notice of intent from the Conservation Commission. We do have work within their buffer zone. There's no wetland impact, but it is buffer zone work. So we will need a permit through them, which our first hearing is scheduled for January 25th. And then finally, we've got a DRB hearing, I believe, is scheduled for the 19th of this month to start the process there. So I actually have 11 by 17s of this. I can hand it out to you if you find it helpful. I don't know how well you can see this from here.
I think it might be helpful.
I'll hand a few out just in case it's easier for you. What you have is an overall and then a blow up of each village underneath it. So it is four sheets. So the plan that you're looking at, the plan that was submitted was essentially a 100-plus page submittal. It was very very comprehensive based on the size of the property. That's the roll right up there. So for ease of presentation, what I wanted to do was just prepare a graphic that just shows the overall property in the three villages. This plan is oriented a little bit different than the last one we looked. North is actually to the left, south to the right. You'll notice there's a red line that's a little bit hard to see. That's just the outline of the entire property on the north. You can see the aerial photography is a little bit darker than it dims out behind it, just to give it a little bit more context. There's a yellow line located here. That actually defines the property limits of the project on either side. So essentially, the overall design theme was based on the OSMA guidelines, as Elaine had mentioned. There were design principles that were outlined that we needed to follow and adhere to. The design that has been prepared and submitted is in full compliance with those guidelines. We're not requesting any waivers or deviations from that as part of this submittal. As I mentioned, there are 425 units on the north side here as part of this particular development. These consist of 201 simplex units and another 224 multifamily attached units, and that definition again is outlined in the special permit. Of the simplex units, 87 will have two bedrooms, and 114 would have three bedrooms. So all told, will be about 940 bedrooms within the process. All homes are for sale residential uses. It's not a rental development, so they all will be for sale. Similar to the original approvals, there are three separate and distinct villages. The village over here is what we refer to in the original plans as a Northeast Village. This right here is referred to as the North Club Village, and this right here is the Northwest Village. Again, Pulte is proposing to purchase 112 acres. Again, that is shown within that yellow dashed line here and on this side over here. Of that area, the proposed buildable land will be reduced from 89.1 acres down to 74.5. This is detailed within the full plan set that you have with more information. As part of the development, there were requirements that you need to provide 1.8 acres or a minimum of 1.8 acres of essentially restricted lands for every land of buildable area. So this development would contribute to requiring about 134 acres within the entire development of restricted lands. The villages all connect to Legacy Farms, Farm Road North, in six separate and distinct locations. There's one here, another here, 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 and here. Well, what we wanted to do is really minimize the connections to that main spine road. It has a lot of different benefits. And number one, it's just a better traffic design to have minimal access points. Secondly, it will provide the development with an overall better, really better neighborhood feel. It allows us to provide better buffering as well to the main road. There was a supplemental traffic investigation that was prepared and submitted as part of our application. Essentially, that concluded that the findings in the original studies that were prepared to the board are consistent with this development. There's really no changes associated with it. One of the goals that we really wanted to do as part of the development, when we look close at this, we wanted to really pull all of the work as much as possible away from that main spine road over here. As you can see, we pulled everything further into the site over here and back over here. We wanted to create some buffers along the roadway. At the same time, we also wanted to pull things further away from the resource area to the extent that we could and provide some additional restricted land there. So if I could just show that one other exhibit, Nate. This will really just point out how the buildable areas changed, just to kind of give you a context of what I was talking about earlier. What you see here is our proposed development. What I really want to highlight is the yellow color. So those yellow areas over here is what was previously shown as buildable land. You'll note that we pulled that back further into the site. Similarly, on this side, we pulled everything back away from the resource areas and again up along here. So the purpose of this graphic was really just to show that we're trying to pull things away from the road. I think that is important. If you can go back to the main one now, Nate, thank you. So of the plan that we submitted, the roadway system all consists of 18 to 20-foot wide roadways. That was consistent with the master plan special permit. We had a staff meeting early on, and it was brought up by the fire department. Essentially, they wanted to make sure that all roads were 20 feet, not 18. So we did have a couple of these smaller spurs, like for instance over here and over here, that were reduced. We will be revising that to provide 20 feet all throughout to comply with what the fire department was asking for. You'll note the roadway system is looped essentially all throughout the development, and you have large loop connections here. The purpose of that again was to give this somewhat of a neighborhood feel, but also we wanted to make sure that it was adequate for emergency vehicles to get to the site. There weren't any very long dead ends that you could just kind of go in and not really get out of. So we wanted to ensure that everything, every dead end was less than 1,000 feet, which it is, and there were adequate turnaround areas for emergency vehicles within the development, which there are. You'll note we also try to provide some curved roads. Essentially, by looping that, that's one of the benefits. But we wanted to make sure we had some curved roads where we could to add a little bit of character to the neighborhood as well. Where we weren't able to have curved roadways, what we tried to do, and you'll see it better on the other graphics. It's hard to see on this one. We tried to step back some of the houses a little bit so you didn't have the same elevation of the building front. We tried to step them back a little bit. Your peer reviewer did comment on that, and it was one thing he asked if we could try to do that a little bit more, so we'll take a closer look, but that was one of the goals that we're trying to accomplish. All of the roadways have a sidewalk on one side of the road. It was very important to make sure that this was a walkable community. There is a very extensive proposed trail network associated with the project, so we wanted to make sure that we could walk from the homes to that open space. That is a huge amenity of this project, getting to that open space and really the walkability within the site. All of the simplex units, you'll note, they are approximately no more than 20 feet apart from one another. The goal, and that's a requirement of the master plan special permit, I think the goal of that when that was written was really to ensure that the development is essentially pushed into one area where the development is, which would allow for larger contiguous areas of open space. So what we did was comply with that. So you'll note all the houses are complying with that separation. So you have these large areas of open space, abutting the project. All of the homes will also have a two-car garage associated with them. So essentially, between the driveway and the garage, there will be four parking spaces per unit. This will easily comply with the master plan special permit requirement of two per unit. From a grading standpoint, the project is a little bit different than some of the other development you've seen on the south side. It was a little more flat topography there. Here the topography is actually quite varied. It actually gives a little bit more challenges, but I think there's some inherent benefits in that as well. But from a grading standpoint, focusing on the northeast village over here, the driveway, we're at about an elevation 462 at the roadway over here, and it drops all the way down at the detention basin to 356. So that's about a 100-foot drop, the existing grade through there. So we wanted to be very careful with that grading and how we dealt with that. On the North Club Village, which is here, again, similarly, grades about 444 here and about 480 over there. So approximately a 35-foot difference from the existing grades. And then finally, on the Northwest Village, we were 480 over here, and then it sloped all the way down back to 402 to the rear of the site. So again, because of these grades, we needed to make sure we looked very carefully at the roadway design and really try to work in with the topography that was there. We wanted to make sure that we were minimizing the earthwork on the property. We wanted to make sure that we were balancing the cuts and fills on the site, which I think we've done a good job of doing that. The maximum road slope that we have is a 7% roadway. Again, that complies with the ordinance. It's within the allowable tolerance. Cuts and fills are essentially balanced on the property as well. During the staff meeting that we had, one comment that came up was they wanted to ensure that the main roadway here wasn't going to be essentially a haul road for the development. So since that meeting, we took a closer look at really our phasing and how we're looking to develop the project. And what we've done is, even though it's a balanced site, we'll be moving some dirt around. We've identified essentially one crossing point on the roadway here where if any material needs to move back and forth, we'll cross it at one location and essentially just utilize the existing lands outside of that to move the materials back and forth. So I think we wanted to be cognizant of that concern. We'll be submitting just more detailed plans showing that to the board. Another indirect benefit, really, of the topography It helps out with the buffering. You know, based on the topo, essentially you've got a ridge line here and everything slopes down this way. So we've got some nice views essentially as the project slopes down, just overlooking the other homes within it. And on this side here, these houses are actually about 50 feet higher than the road in that area too. So they're looking up over the road and set back kind of far. So that's a nice benefit. That's really an indirect benefit for the topography that we have. From a stormwater management standpoint, again, we designed the project to be compliant with the state and local regulations. Similar to the south side, the drainage is handled by a series of bioretention basins as well as infiltration detention basins. We scattered those throughout the different villages. So in this village over here, you'll notice we've got a drainage area back over here and back in this area. We also have a little bioretention area over here and back over there. In the village here, the Northwest Village, the drainage is essentially pushed to this point over here. We wanted to maintain the same drainage patterns as there are today. Again, we worked with the topography to make sure we're all going in the same area and within the appropriate flows. And then on the North Club Village, drainage basins are located here, here, and here. So along this area, we provided drainage. We just received some peer review comments from your peer review engineer. Received that today, so we'll be looking through that and addressing any comments that we need to on that end. From a utility standpoint, sewer is private. Essentially, as part of the earlier development on the south, there was a wastewater treatment plant that was constructed. Everything on this side will get pumped over, will get pumped and go to the other side. We have a couple of pump stations that are proposed. We have one located over here and another back in this area over here. From municipal water, we do have municipal water. There's a 12-inch main that's been constructed within Legacy Farms Road North. We'll be connecting into that with either 8 or 12-inch lines, depending on exactly what area of the site. Those are outlined in the big roll of plans you have right there. Gas, electric, telephone, cable, all of that will be extended to the development as well. There is provisions on the north side for some additional development that is not part of what we're proposing. I think there's an additional age-restricted development. We did make provisions, and again, you can see it when Matt goes through his plans, but we made provisions for a connection to that development so that you wouldn't have to necessarily use the main roadway for all of that. So we did make provisions with how we sited the house to plan for that future development. Relative to some services, trash pickup, again, that will be handled by private haulers. It's going to be the same as it is on the south side today, so no change from that. Snow removal, again, similar to how it is on the south side. You know, snow would get plowed off to the side of the roads and the shoulders and the areas aside that are provided on the units. We did prepare a comprehensive landscape plan. Essentially, that outlines the landscape concept, the entry features, the overall landscape theme, provides a blend of existing proposed trees, planting mature trees that we're able to save. We showed where those were. So I'm going to turn it over to Matt, who can get into that in a little bit more detail, and he'll show you some blow-ups of each of those three villages, which should be able to see a little bit more. And again, those are in the packet that I handed you. It's the supplement sheets after that first one.
Thank you, John. Again, my name is Matt Merva, landscape architect with Bowler Engineering. We've been working with the team to prepare the landscape concept that you see before you on these plans, which goes into much greater detail in the big roll of drawings that you have on the table there. Without getting into all the detailed specifics tonight, I just wanted to kind of walk you through some of the general concepts and be able to start to answer some questions that you might have as you go through it in greater detail. But from an overall concept standpoint, what we were really looking to try to do here is to create some neighborhood identity within this overall development. We've already discussed how it's broken down into three separate villages, but even within those villages, we're trying to create some neighborhood identity through the use of varying street tree patterns within those areas. So you'll find when you look at the detailed plans that we use a different street tree here in this little sub-village, different from the street tree that's used in this sub-village, so that as you drive through, you start to see a different character. Different times of year will have different fall color to create some interest, so it's not a monotonous landscape. There's some seasonal interest there that we're pretty excited about. As another way of breaking down the area into distinct neighborhoods, we've also looked at different treatments for how the entries into the site are handled at each of these locations along the main spine road. So those are treated with stone piers, decorative stone piers. There'll be 15-foot decorative street lights at those intersections, along with sections of split rail fence, white cedar split rail fence that'll be stained white as well. And this family of fixtures and features will start to, you'll see that throughout the village, and those themes get carried through into the smaller intersections deeper within the site in more subtle ways. You still have the street lights at those intersections, decorative street signs with a similar wood that's used on those split rail fences, and those themes carry throughout. One of the main features of the landscape design is not just what we're planting, but what we're trying to save here. John's already mentioned that we're providing a compact development footprint that allows for a lot of mature vegetation at the buffers to be saved, so that views into and out of the site are mitigated and buffered to the extent possible. We're also providing for some existing mature vegetation to be saved along that spine road, so that it does tend to buffer the view from that spine road into these neighborhoods. But to augment that, there, in addition to the proposed street trees that were originally intended along the spine road, we're also suggesting areas of increased buffer between the spine road and the rear units that do face out onto that road. So you'll see in the detailed plans, we've got a mixture of different types of evergreens, eastern red cedar, white pine, spruce, that will enhance that buffer and create some visual separation from the spine road to those units. We're also providing that buffering back in the site to buffer those neighborhoods from each other, so that people aren't looking directly into the units of their neighbors behind them. So there's that additional evergreen screen beyond that buffers those individual homes. And then there are several locations where we've identified some large specimen trees that we're going to hang on to, especially at the borders of the site. You know, 36 to 48 inch caliper existing vegetation. This being a former nursery site, a lot of the vegetation has been farmed, and there aren't many examples of mature vegetation, but where we are able to maintain it, we certainly are making every effort to do that. We are providing some enhanced landscape features at various areas around the site. Nate, if you could go to the North Club Village, please. Actually, this is perfect. No, this is great. So along the spine road here, you'll see this is some of the existing vegetation that I mentioned that we're going to be keeping, so that there is that visual separation between the units up on top of the hill down to the spine road. Where we are regrading in some areas, we're providing additional proposed vegetation along that area, both at the upper and lower levels of the site. As we come around the corner here, we're providing a new tot lot space, an outdoor amenity area for residents of the entire property to share. We've got a park space here that provides the entry to the next village here, which, Nate, if you could flip to the next. Yes, sir. Yes, these are bioretention areas. So that would all be vegetated as well. Can you go? Yeah, thanks, Nate. Okay, so we flipped orientation here, but this is actually a linear park that begins the entrance into the northwest village. So that park space has a stone wall at its entry, the lights and piers that I mentioned, a small pocket park at this corner here as you enter into this neighborhood. And we continue that street tree pattern that I mentioned earlier. We have street trees pretty much at every home, buffering that street edge so that the long corridor view down that roadway is broken up by this proposed vegetation. You can see these pockets of existing vegetation that we are maintaining to provide some additional buffer. So we're keeping our grading and utility and construction operations out of those spaces in order to maintain that mature vegetation where we can. The bioretention areas that you just brought up, there are detailed plans for those on subsequent sheets. These are really just showing the massing areas at this scale because it is such a large scale. But we've gotten into great detail on the design of those to provide for naturalized vegetation that will make that an attractive area for residents to look out onto and to perform that stormwater function that we needed to perform. Yep, those are the buffer areas from the resource area.
This is clarification, you're saying 50 feet, 100 feet, or?
Correct. So that's the edge of the resource itself. That's 50 foot. That's 100.
So the dark blue line is the left.
Yeah, you can see the dark blue here, and then there's the 50-foot buffer, and then the 100-foot buffer. The trees and shrubs we're providing, they're numerous. We're trying to provide a variety of seasonal interests. So we've got a lot of deciduous material, a lot of flowering, ornamental material that we'll use as accent and in pockets where we want to highlight certain areas. We've got perennials and smaller scale vegetation proposed for these bioretention areas. And we go into great detail in the plan. I don't want to take up too much time tonight as we're introducing the project, but glad to answer any questions anyone might have as we move through those on the specific treatments for any specific area. John mentioned briefly the trail network. Nate, if you could go back to the overall illustrative slide. I believe we have a plan that shows the overall trail network, but all of the walkways that John mentioned that are within these villages along one side of the road will connect the residents of these different villages into that overall master trail network. So this is a real walkable community, not only at this village scale, but out into the larger site beyond. So we really see that as a positive amenity for this development. Yes?
When the town of Hopkinton and the townspeople agreed to partner with Legacy Farms to move forward with this development. One of the assets for the town was the preservation of 500 acres of open space. And I know you have mentioned that these trails and the pedestrian connectivity provide a nice amenity for the residents of these new homes. But for the townspeople who agreed to move forward with this partnership, the amenity was those 500 acres of open space. And as this is designed right now on the surface, I do not see any provisions for the general public to access this open space through any kind of a parking area. It looks to me like a fast road going through, an individual neighborhood can beat up parking somewhere on the street and walk through their yard. So unless I am wrong, I would hope going forward that design in this plan will be accessed for the townspeople of Hopkinton to drive to and enjoy the 500 acres of open space that were critical to our agreement to move forward in this development.
Sure, we can address that later on as well. I think that concludes the introduction to the landscape architectural portion of the presentation.
Okay. At this point, we're done with the first two items. The next item on the outline is the opportunity to add to the outline. Hopefully people are following along with the outline. It is 3 pages long, particularly the general discussion areas part that I'm going to set the framework for the detailed discussion as to how these other villages fit in. So anyone from the planning board or the public have any items that we missed? Elaine worked hard on the outline. I worked on it for a little while. A couple members, I think, might have worked on it. Beta worked on it at one point, so we tried to get pretty much in here. I mean, this is an incredibly large project. It's, what, 6-7% of our housing stock coming up, something like that. So it's a key project, you know, for the town. But I'm satisfied that there's enough in the outline, but that isn't, you know, you got some more or anything?
I need to flesh out a little bit more of a talking point about the density, and I think this is a really good plan overall, but I have some questions and some things along the line that have been brought up tonight that I'd like to talk to you about more specifically.
Okay. Why don't we add density to... Real, the question was, should townhouses be part of the mix, which was kind of our way of thinking about density, because you get rid of a few more spaces. But well, I just marked density right after that, because it's
also once it's an idea how they're placed, and some of the feedback to the statements that we heard tonight. I don't know if tonight would be a good time or further down the line.
Let's get through finalizing that we're happy with the outline. After the outline, then we'll start going down the outline.
So, Mr. Chairman, I have one thing to potentially add.
Okay.
And that's really kind of a lesson to learn from what you guys did on the south side. Is there anything, I'm sure you guys are noticing some of those, but I'd like to just hear some of those lessons learned and how do they potentially apply to the north side. And actually from the developers, but also from the planning.
Why don't I add that to the lessons learned to the last item on the general discussion, and then if we miss something, then we've got to catch all this to get it all. The lesson learned was a lot of these items that are here
are from the lesson.
Sure.
Other items you see down.
anyone from the general public? Sounds like you got enough out of it.
You say we won't add something if we discover something where it's going, but at least we have the expectation that everyone will be prepared to down the list. So we have another 10 minutes, so I think we can get started on the general discussion. And the first item on the general discussion is who makes the commitments for the poultry organization? Mark?
Either myself or anything that we say in the public forum is qualified. Yeah.
Mark,
what's your title of the poultry? Land title and manager.
Land what?
Entitlement manager.
Okay. So you're part of the you're in charge of the permitting process?
Design and permanent entitlements.
Okay. Do the construction people work for you?
We all work for Poultry Homes in New England, so.
We heard, and this is one of my lessons learned, that the construction people don't listen to what Mr. Luke basically committed to this board on the south side. I can't remember the exact meeting, but
we did have that discussion. And quite frankly, we're hoping that whoever is representing Pulte to us is speaking for the construction firm, because quite frankly, permitting wise, you guys were in pretty good shape when you left here. And it's more during the execution phase that at minimum you've kind of made a lot of residents around you not so happy with you, let me put it just nicely today.
So basically this to me ended up being first on the list, because to commitment, the planning board is going to speak as a board together with a vote and commit for the town aspect. We're expecting you to commit for the poultry organization, and there's certain things, because the way I hear that the sales guys don't talk to the
operations guys, and they don't talk to the permitting guys, and they just pass the plans over and say kind of go build something.
And this part of commitment is very important to me, and I think there's certain parts of the commitment as we go through some of these lessons learned and things that we're going to ask for you a commitment from your boss, where all three pieces work together, and certain areas like maybe a construction management plan, where it's signed off by the guy that's going to be in charge of the construction, who's going to be responsible for the construction. I personally just think that commitment and speaking for the organization is critical for us, you know, because we the town have a relationship with you. We got a problem during the construction phase. We call you guys first because we know who you are, because you've sat many hours with us, and you know we want that to work better than it did the last time.
And our reputation is very important to us. We work in a lot of different communities, and I think any commitments that we or I make in this setting and on the plans and in the permits, you know, we expect that our company will comply with those completely. So that's our expectation, and any hiccups that we may have had on the south, I hope we'll be buying them out, and I hope we can put those up again. I hope we can do that.
Go ahead.
So, Mark, with all due respect, I would look at somebody who's an officer of the organization, somebody at VP or SVP level higher, to make that level of commitment. Because you may or may not. And, sir, are you the person that can provide?
Yeah, so, Mr. Chairman, if I may.
Sure.
So, my name is Bruce Luke, and Mark introduced me earlier, and worked with the Owens, and my vice president.
I concur with everything that Mark has said as far as the commitment is concerned. We were here. We take all
all of the discussions, the issues, the designs, comments, and ultimately the decisions that are made very seriously. And we do our best to pass on all the intricacies to everyone in the organization. And we certainly admit that we're all human. Folks that work with us in our team, even though they're seasoned professionals and we work very closely together, we're all human too, as our vendors, and we're naturally in our business, we're all subject to the whims of Mother Nature and trying to construct a new community with all of the complications, road, rain, wind, sun, and things of that nature, along with the home building. So it is complicated, there's a lot of moving parts, a lot of people. We realize that, but rest assured that I will do my best to be at every single meeting, and any commitments that Mark makes, I will back up, and vice versa. So we'll do our best to adhere to all the requirements of the board, and then we'll do our best to communicate them to them effectively to other folks in the field who carry them out. And as far as the contact, if there are issues, you can certainly contact us. You have our contact information, and we have, in many cases, our offices directly next door to the other individuals who are responsible for the other departments who work, sales, construction, customer relations, things of that nature. So it's especially in the day and age that we live, technology allows us to communicate very rapidly with anyone who needs to. So we'll ask about all of their expectations. Kind of
do we need to get the construction people here so we have to have them as well?
I think during certain parts, I think we need to do some more in that particular area, because I mean, that's where the breakdown really was. Let's try to get the next one introduced, and then we'll probably, after about 4 minutes or so, we'll be starting to run out of time here. Next one is the importance of trail connections. I think Claire started on that. The trail restricted parking area and other amenities, and how does it fit in with the master plan and special permit overview? Kind of what I'm expecting is, I believe there was a trail map in the first, in the master plan. How does this kind of all fit together? I mean, it's clear that other than a few spots, there isn't, you can't walk through this development. I mean, you know, I mean, in the 20-foot spacing between two homes, we're not going to put a trail in that 20 feet. So basically, you know, I view these as kind of long fences, and you know, maybe the trail network as proposed in the master plan originally was going around all these, because I quite frankly can't remember the details from back in those years. So what I'd like to kind of see for homework for the next one, let's look at what we had at the master plan special permit area, which had a lot of trails, and then overlay everything you've got, you know, on it, maybe with different color codes. And you know, I purposely had this in the outline early on, because the last time on the south side, we kind of put the trails in after we kind of built everything up. And the north side, from when we talked about it during the early part of the progress, the trails were going to be the important spot. You know, there's a commitment for some horse trails onto the north side. You know, we're going to connect with the athletic parcel up and around and up on the hill and to the state park. And yeah, Claire?
There also needs to be a parking area.
Oh, absolutely.
You know,
yep.
It's not great to park in people's front yards.
Yes.
And especially the people that live in the area, because one of the first people to come, we'd be able to come, park, and do the trails.
Go ahead, Roy.
Mr. Chairman, Roy McDowell from Legacy Farms. It is the intent of Legacy Farms to work closely with Pulte to define more definitive trails, but also to deal with the trails committee. I'd like to arrange that with the to make sure that we're looking at various areas where not only do we want to start, but frankly, where we want to end up. And there's no question we
some of the, I guess, suggestions, you know, we had some expectation that the master plan special permit area as to where the trails and where, there was a general trail map, I believe, at that point. Who is doing the restricted land around these parcels? Are you doing that, or is Polk?
The restricted land within the purchase components of the land that are on the units themselves, that restricted land would be part of their restriction. That's a very minimal amount of restricted land. The vast majority of the restricted land would be done by us.
So basically, you're going to be responsible for taking out the old roadways and putting maybe a trail in, or if it needs to be done. Okay.
Matter of fact, we've also been doing a survey. I don't know if you can see the survey, West Treasury, colored coded. It's a colored coded plan. It's a graph that shows the restricted land, the whole north side, broken down to approximate timelines of 2016, 17, 18, and sort of outlines when those pieces would be restricted.
Okay.
We can get that to the board next time.
I think that would be good that we kind of start with those kind of action items at the next time. I mean, I think we started 5 minutes late, so I'm going to give it another. Okay. We started about 5 minutes late, so let's continue with another 5 minutes, and then we've got a couple of motions we've got to make. The next one that I want just people to start thinking about, but maybe we don't have enough time to discuss it, buildable versus restricted parcel, there's a lot of really small strips into that. And I want to kind of know where the accounting is. To me, a restricted land, and particularly the one that was on the hillside in between a couple, it looked like it was so restricted nobody can be on it because the slope was like one of these, if I remember right. I don't know what the value of that is for restricted land other than the fact that it certainly isn't buildable. But we'll get into that discussion a little bit more maybe with the next one. But I just wanted to get people thinking about this is your accountability. How close are we to 500 acres? But we can talk about that more. Okay, well, for example, a small strip in between two rows of houses and the only access is through the 20-foot strip between the two houses is, you know, there's no public benefit to that.
Mr. Chairman, I think when one looks at the classifications of restrictions, one of them is actually for lack of use of the strip house. So that may very well fall into that category.
Okay. Okay, we'll spend that. That's we're going to go. A couple things before we leave here. And by the way, during this general discussion, the public is more than welcome to jump in on a lot of these particular trails and things that I know people have an interest in. Before we leave, everyone, this is the time to get your comments in.
Is there any intent to connect to existing trails that, say, are not within this subdivision?
Yes. The answer in general is yes. I mean, it's to, you know, there's a lot of people that I'll say walk this area currently connecting from whatever, and some of this will be put in, and, you know, maybe from your subdivision, you can then go across the trails and walk over to the reservoir. What? Yeah. Yes. Okay. Speaking of walking the property, I think we're going to want some sidewalks. Just looked at the weather forecast for Saturday. I don't have enough detail. It might even be snow and whatever. But if it's easy for the planning board members, but I would look for people to sign up and get the alerts or whatever, we would post that as a meeting. I think, Elaine, maybe we'll look at almost every Saturday coming up, or Sunday, or whatever, and when the weather gets to be where it's reasonable to go out, you know, we might have some 70-degree Saturdays, you know, like we had a couple of weeks ago. And it's, you know, it's a great hike. But we'll post that, the planning board will get emails as to, and if we can get people to say four or five of us that can make it, then we'll go walk in the mud or whatever, no, the snow. If so, and the public's welcome to go along on that, and hopefully we'll be able to take enough of the maps along that we won't get ourselves too terribly lost. And maybe we'll focus in on the part that's closest to Franklin Road first, just because we have a room that we can get to it. Also, planning board members, you know, most of the road is paved, or half the road is paved.
About
60%. And, you know, there's access into it. There's just a Jersey barrier that you got to kind of skirt around the one end of it. And it's worth the drive up there, particularly before it snows. That's why maybe Saturday is not going to be the day, but we'll do our best.
If our team can help you navigate your way through the site, whatever assistance we can give the board, we're happy to provide. We have a pretty good idea of where things are up there and how to get it.
One thing that might help is if you put up a 2x2 post where every one of the six driveways come through. That might help.
You can do that, although there are already pretty much, so if you drive the road that's paved, all of the driveways have stubs, and you can see water, gas, stuff. So it's pretty.
Okay.
Maybe you can put a ribbon on them, just so if I say, you know, we'll put like a pink ribbon at each of the driveways so that would further.
That might help. Yeah.
Maybe I'll shoot Elaine an email with exactly what we did.
Okay. So that might be coming on. Elaine, when's the next time we have time available?
How much of a block of time?
What?
How much of a block of time?
Each an hour.
Is that the next meeting, you're full up till 9 o'clock?
So we could start at 9?
We could start at 9.
Okay.
That's the 25th.
Am I really full up to 9?
Unless there's cancellations.
Okay. So you might.
You do have a couple of hearings.
We have to prove minutes and stuff. But so next meeting is the 25th.
At 9 o'clock.
There are members that know they're not going to be here. This is the other thing. There's going to be enough hearings that we've got to make sure we preserve everyone's ability to vote on this thing. It looks like I'm looking for a motion for 9 o'clock on the 25th to continue the public hearing for both. Moved and seconded. All further discussion?
Okay.
Go ahead.
On the 25th, we have at 8:30 the continuation of Leonard Street, the subdivision off Leonard Street, which we really only expect to be 10 minutes or so.
Could shorten that time up.
Why don't we do it at 8:45? You might be delayed. We're going to get those guys done. Okay, so amend the motion to 8:45. Seconded and what? Okay. Okay, so it's continue to 8:45 on the 25th. Further discussion? Opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. Thank you. Okay.
Well, it's the only one we've got left.
Okay. Do you need this?
I have it electronically.
Okay, then you'll get it.
It's still draft, so that's why it's...
It's okay. Okay, we're going to move on to the next one. We have continued public hearing, site plan review application, 34 to 40 Hayden Rowe Street, RIP Hopkinton LLC, and note that Claire stepped off the board. And why don't you guys start and tell us where exactly we are? Refresh our memories.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. For the applicant, RPI, Jerry Efron. When we last convened December 21st, we were down really to, I believe, one issue. I have read the report of to you from the director. I concur in the accuracy of that report. Essentially, following the lead of the board at the conclusion of that meeting, we tried to resolve the logjam concerning the adequacy of screening to Mr. and Mrs. Wright's property. We've presented two detailed alternatives for screening in two landscape plans that were drawn. One was a combination of vegetation and a fence. The other was simply a vegetative screening consisting of 28 arborvitaes and 36 yews. Lined up so that they would provide essentially a double vegetative screen. We were fortunate to hear from Mrs. Wright in writing that she preferred the alternative for the vegetative screening. We forwarded that information to the director along with a detailed architectural plan. Reviewing my notes before I came over here tonight, I did go back and realize that, you know, the peer reviewer had signed off on all of these things as far as not only this issue, but every other issue, including the screening issue in terms of the adequacy. So this was really the only item that was left. We're hoping at this particular point that there being at least an indication of concurrence with the adequacy of that the board will also so find. And if that's the case, we would hope that you would believe that you have enough information to make a decision, that you would concur with the recommendations to then close the hearing, and we would then hope to receive an affirmative vote on the site plan. With me tonight is Mr. Levy from the applicant, Mr. Mark Winona, our engineer, and Mike Radner, our landscape architect, for any questions you might have.
Members of the board, are you? My recollection is it was down to this one last item. I think that's where we were. This is right. They represented your concurrence in which design to pick. Go ahead.
I would like to speak to one other thing on the screening, and unfortunately a couple of points that I have since noticed on lighting, and I apologize for bringing up additional issues, but I hope the board will understand that this change to 24-hour day 34 bedroom condominiums has a lot of potential for a significantly different impact on our property than the business Monday through Friday daytime use. So I do see this planning board meeting as our only opportunity to really try to get it right for us. So I would like to just mention a couple things on the screening. I appreciate the solution you've come to, Mr. Ferrari's suggestion of the hedge to block the parking lot's lights is a very good one. And unfortunately tonight, I noticed that there's an upper parking lot that also faces our property. And again, these uses have been strictly business Monday through Friday, so the impact hasn't been the same as if this happens 7 days a week. The cars in that upper parking lot, there's an edge of a deciduous hedge, which has no leaves on it right now. And as it turned out tonight, a couple cars turned their headlights on and sat in the parking lot with the headlights shining right at us for quite a period of time before they left. And I noticed that the landscaping plan for that upper parking lot edge, which is elevated, so it can't really be screened from below, includes just daylilies and perennials. Because we obviously saw headlights that shone directly on us for a period of time, I think that Mr. Ferrari's suggestion of the planting of the thicker hedge, the yews, would be appropriate in that area as well, because this is something that may happen and it happened tonight. So I would like to ask for that, and I had a couple lighting.
Parking area, you got at least me confused as to where.
There is a strip of 21 spaces that are directly up against us, and then across from the driveway, up against the building, there is an elevated parking area. These cars are up in the air, looking down. Those are existing. I can point it out in the
plans. Yeah, thank you. Which page works the best? Are we talking, you think right in here?
Sheet L1.
Well, this is 499. I don't know if you'll.
Up and show us what you. This is reserved for the business center.
This is reserved for the business center. This is reserved for the business center. And this is going to be for kids' borough. This is for kids' borough. This is for kids' borough. So this is not changing the residential use. This is the same amount of commercial use.
So,
if
you're talking about
guarantee,
these will not be used in regular parking spaces beyond just the money to try to business use. What's to prevent your residents from parking over there?
Or
there, yeah. I understand the question. She's telling me what it's intended to do. We're also trying to keep, this is the entrance to the residences, and all guest spaces and all of the spaces are basically this way. But this is intended to be continued for commercial use.
You're putting the U's here.
Yeah. These are the values you will know the same line as this.
Is, I believe it's 20 feet.
Right.
So don't they block the light from here?
Well,
this is 5 miles.
2 feet. By 2 feet.
Down.
This is 499 here.
This will be 499.
I'm just not trying to. Maybe you can help me understand it. But you got a line of used to here. So they're going
to arborvitae.
Arborvitae. They're going to provide a pretty good hedge. I mean,
as they grow.
As they grow.
Well,
what's the height when you plant them?
Mm-hmm. 4 to 5 feet. Only 2 feet below that grade. These are 2 feet below this grade. This is down a little bit further. This is 7 feet.
The grade elevation approximately 4 and 4.5 through there,
so it's 8 feet below.
So in the marking lot will be at 499, 499. Slope down, and so 498 here. The creek was higher. The common boundary line. And then this will snap up 2 feet and 5 feet.
Chairman, what they're proposing here is not making the situation any worse, is it?
I think so.
Than what's existing.
I understand the parking spaces along the line there make it worse, but the existing parking spaces, that doesn't make it worse than, or what they're proposing here is not making the existing situation any worse, is it?
That's an opinion.
I think it makes it worse. In terms of, well, this is something that, because it's a change from public commercial to mixed use of commercial residential, that the residential parking now that could occur at a higher elevation could be perceived as making it worse. And then I think what I've heard from the government about that, we put signs saying, well, no parking here, this is far right, this is a commercial only.
Yeah, I mean, these are going to be reserved for the business center anyway, and there's going to be signs so that residents don't park there and get the spaces that are intended for the business center. The business center's entrance is going to be over here now, so we want the people that are using the business center to be as close as possible.
So kind of separating the look from the other. And then the lights are higher up, and for some vegetation plants that are in place. Or is this what they're presenting?
This seems like it meets everything that was initially requested. I think if I'm putting the sign there, you've got to assume that the business owners are going to be respectful of that, or the residents who live apart there are going to see the risk of potentially being towed. The other thing is, within a year or 18 months, that arborvitae is probably going to grow high enough to cover it.
I think picking up on the general tenor of all of the comments, everyone's comments. Number one, I'm pretty sure it's probably not appropriate to assume illegal and improper use on a decision. unless there's a design defect, which I don't think we have. And second, I think there is a bylaw on screening, and the screening has to be adequate. I don't think that the screening has to create an impervious block against lighting from cars. This isn't, we're not talking about screening lighting from a building or from inside. These are car lights. And so I'm hoping that you would believe that the screening is reasonable. Your peer reviewer found a lesser screening plan adequate, and I'm hoping that you would see that to try to impose any conditions beyond that would potentially stretch things just a little bit too far. Thank you.
And a potential condition that talks about putting in a reserve for business parking condition for that area.
Like a small sign.
Small sign. Okay. Other public comment? Yes, go ahead, Claire.
I also have a question about the lighting. Could the applicant explain what kind of light fixtures these are that are around the parking lot? Because on the lighting plan, it shows 10 fixtures, five on our side and five on the other side. It's basically one fixture for every two spots. And I have not seen any cut sheets on either that or the pole fixture that actually show what it is. Is that a wall fixture, or what kind of a fixture is needed where you need one light fixture for every two parking spaces? And the reason I ask the question is because if it's a wall-mounted light, what's happening right now is there's a single light mounted on the corner of the building, which is not too bad, but it shines onto the clapboard. And what happens is that light bounces off the clapboard, so that it may not show up as a lot of light on the lighting plan, but someone looking at that, you get these brightly lit clapboards. So where I'm seeing five lights across a 10 parking spot strip that show 8.5 foot candles under each one, I'm just wondering what kind of light that is. Is that much needed, or could it be reduced?
For my sheet L2 is the lighting plan.
Underneath the car port, so they're mounted an overhang.
I see.
They're down lights, okay. And they're mounted at 8.5 foot height.
Okay, so it's not shining on the building.
No, they're a down light.
Okay.
And this is the top of these.
Okay.
I don't have that particular one.
Go ahead.
And one more question on the lighting plan right here.
Is that, although it's not part of the site plan, it's on the property, which is owned by the applicant. This shows, over on this side, on the hospitality side, this shows zero. The daycare center has installed a totally unshielded LED floodlight, which is in violation of our bylaws, that there can't be unshielded floodlights.
And so this lighting plan that shows zero is really a misrepresentation, because the actual site has a very powerful floodlight that is on.
I'm assuming that you are going to correct that and make it.
I'm pretty sure it's all
right.
Yeah, Jim Callery, 4 Maple. You did put a hood on it, but it doesn't work. I mean, if you drive by it, you from the road, it's in your eyes. So I know you made the effort, you did listen, you put a hood on it. But if to look at it during the day, looks like it's shielded. But if you drive by it at night, it's a bright light in your face, even if you're up Church Street. So it's lighting all of the day. It's lighting all the way out. What's that, 120 feet out to church? So it's still pretty bright.
There's a certain amount that we had to leave it for safety reasons at night.
Well, you could have deployed individual lights along that. I think Claire's right. I think it doesn't meet the building inspection requirements that it's bright.
In that back, after the daycare center is closed, it's a playground, and there's no reason that can be a motion sensor or a timer that after the daycare center is closed, that there's no need for this lighting. All the houses on Church Street have to pull their shades, and unless they're worried about the raccoons going down the slide, at night. There's no reason that light has to be there. It needs to be corrected for the neighbors.
We have a condition on item 5 that talks about lighting, exterior lighting. And the question is, how about a reduction in light levels in the playground area after pickup? Children is complete. Hopefully that fixture gets modified again, maybe so that it actually can get more lights. Okay. Other comments? Yes, sir.
One more question. Can the applicant just explain what's going on with the trash, these dumpsters out there? Are those moving? Are there hours when those dumpsters will be serviced? Can you just explain what's going on?
We have a proposed condition of 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. for emptying of trash.
Every day? Is it weekends, weekdays? Is it?
Eight to five is, we normally don't specify day of the week to week. Okay. It's the 8 to 5 is what we. Are they emptying it before 8 in the morning now?
It's happened. Sure.
I don't know whether that condition was in the previous one or not, but certainly it's part of our condition tonight. Okay. We have 3 votes to do it. Is there any other public comment?
I just want to ask, on that floodlight, one of the votes to approve the site plan with conditions says exterior lighting of the site shall be as depicted on the plans.
Sure.
And so with respect to that floodlight, I hope it's more than just, I hope this gets changed, because unless that floodlight is turned off, it's not going to be as depicted on the plans, because the plans show zero, and that's not what the site lighting is.
It's not depicted on the plan, so it should be needs to be removed.
Correct.
As the plans are approved moving forward.
If we're going to approve plans tonight, we're approving the plans that are submitted. That's it, as it is. So then, yes. If it's not that way, the building inspector will have it removed. Okay. We have 3 votes that we need to do. Any other public comment? Okay. The first vote is to grant a waiver from the site plan standard M, which is a requirement for the sidewalk along the frontage of all streets abutting the lot, to not require a sidewalk to be constructed along the Church Street frontage. As a sidewalk is already located on the opposite side of the street, and there's not been a demonstrated need or plan for a sidewalk on both ends, sides of the street. Look for a motion to grant that waiver.
So moved.
Second. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Nay.
Anyone opposed? That's a nay. Anyone abstain?
If I can explain my vote, we talked so much about sidewalks, I'm sad that we're missing an opportunity to build a little bit more sidewalk downtown, but I'm glad I'm here on that.
Okay. Second one is a vote to determine that the plan complies with the site plan standards with the planned conditions of approval. The conditions are 1 through 8, 8 being the sign for the business center parking sign. And for 5, reduction of light areas in the playground area after pickup building is complete. So I look for a motion to determine that the plan complies with the site plan standards with the plan conditions of approval.
1 through 8.
Second. Moved and second. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. The third vote is to vote to approve the site plan with the following conditions. One is mechanical equipment, other utility equipment on the roof grounds. The building shall be screened from the ground, which is site plan Q. Dumpsters will not be emptied before 8 and after 5, site plan standard G. Applicant will be responsible for mitigating all construction-related impacts, including erosion, siltation, and dust control in a timely manner, site plan G. Applicant shall regularly remove construction, trash, and debris from the site in accordance with good construction practice. No tree stumps, demolition material, trash, and debris shall be burned or buried at the site plan G. Exterior lighting of the site shall be as depicted on the plans. No light bulbs or lenses shall protrude below the bottom of the light fixture. Reduction light levels in the play area shall be reduced after the pickup children is complete. It's number 6, that's site standard N. Director of Municipal Inspectors inspect site plans under construction for compliance with the approval site plan. Approve the decision of site plan review if the Director of Municipal Inspection determines at any time before or during the construction a registered professional engineer or other outside professional is required to assist with the inspection of the stormwater management system or any other component of the site plan. The applicant shall be responsible for the cost of those inspections. All site plan standard and section 212.137. Accordance with 210.138 of the zoning bylaws, the applicant should provide a performance guarantee in the amount of $5,000 to the town prior to the commencement of the construction pursuant to this decision. Guarantee shall consist of a deposit of money or negotiable securities in a form selected by the planning board to guarantee that any unforeseen problems which arise, such as erosion and sedimentation, correction of site lighting plans are addressed. These funds will be held by the town and returned to our applicant upon completion of the project. This is zoning bylaw 210.138. And a reserve for business center parking signs shall be placed, I don't know, on the row, wherever. We'll figure out how to say that. So I look for a motion to approve the site plan with the, before we do that, is the applicant okay with the 8 conditions we're at?
We are.
Okay. Look for a motion to approve the site plan with the 8 conditions.
So moved.
Move the second, further discussion.
Discussion?
Yes, go ahead.
I think that a lot of hard work has gone into this on all sides, and other communities than ours as well. But one of the reasons we got here was a decision made by another committee, and a decision I disagree with. And I've been contacted by a lot of people that are concerned about density issues. I brought it up for other projects here tonight as well. So I want to commend the developer for responding to the neighbors' complaints and issues, not complaints, but issues that they have. And I want to commend the neighbors for coming out tonight and spending their personal time being here. But I want to say in advance that I'm voting no, and it's a symbolic no. It's about the density of the project, and I know that it's been approved by an outside committee other than ours, that it could be residential and commercial. And I mean no disrespect to the work that our board has put into this and the developers and the neighbors have come together. But my vote will be no, just to let you guys know that.
We do. Okay, I've been seconded. Any further discussion? Seeing none, you ready for a vote? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Nay.
Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. We'll be right in the decision in the next week or two.
Thank you very much.
Sure. Thank you. Okay, we've got just we got one more major one that we want to get knocked out here. Marathon. Screwed up when I gave 5 more minutes to Legacy. I just will teach me. You were going so well. I was doing well. The Marathon folks here?
Yes.
Okay. Oh, come on. Come on. However, yeah, that'd be great. Okay. We have Marathon Solar LLC. We've already issued a special permit and a stormwater management permit. They are proposing some modifications to, I'll say, lower the density of panels on the site. And if you kind of explain where all the changes are going to be made, hopefully we will get through this.
Yes, thank you very much. My name is Eric Lass, professional engineer and principal at Beals and Thomas. Do appreciate the board adding this item to the agenda this evening. Quick update, the Conservation Commission extended the same courtesy to us last Monday and voted to unanimously approve the same request for minor modification to this project. The applicant, which we note in our letter dated January 4th, the name of that applicant has changed. It's still Marathon Solar LLC, but they've added that it's a Delaware limited liability company to the applicant name. The applicant retained Beals and Thomas to take the previously approved plans from September and bring them to 100% construction level drawings. And in the course of that refinement to CD level plans, we've determined that there would be some adjustments made to the overall array, and that those changes warranted us coming back before you to present those as a minor modification. The project as approved was a 3-megawatt project. It's now proposed to be 2.6 megawatt DC.
Question, why did it get reduced?
Why did it get reduced? So in terms of the proposed racks that are going to be used, there's going to be a single TerraSmart rack that's used, and those have a set dimension. Our approved plans showed multiple types of racks. There were narrower racks on the ends of a lot of these rows that just are not feasible with the rack that the applicant now wants to use. And what that's done is resulted in an overall reduction. If you took all of the rows of panels, right, and added them all up linear feet, there's 4,000 less linear feet of panels now. And that's brought the size of the project down. But but what it's done is it's reduced the footprint. And the Conservation Commission was very pleased that there's 12,000 square feet less impact within the inner 50-foot buffer zone to vegetated wetlands. We've been able to move the fence back from wetland areas. We've been able to reduce the overall length of the rows and add more space between the rows and the security fence for access as well. there's been some slight change to the spacing in the northern section of the array to, again, decrease the overall footprint. The spaces between the rows were originally a consistent 11.5 feet. The northern and southern portion of the array, the spacing, the northern portion of the array now has gotten tighter, so we've been able to tighten that up. We're still proposing the same drip edges every other row, so there'll be no change from a stormwater perspective. There's you know, overall far fewer panels on the site as proposed. And in the southern portion of the array, the spacing has gone from 11.5 feet to 12 feet, so a very slight adjustment there. And again, it's just been a refinement working with this applicant to bring this to 100% level.
So if I look at this plan, just to try to cut yes. to the chase here, where it's got some really light gray, that was the one we approved, and this is the new one?
That is correct. The sheet C 2.1 through 2.3, we added those to the set for the convenience of the board to be able to clearly see the differences from the previously approved array in the lighter gray to the currently proposed in the darker. I know it's somewhat hard to see here, but you can see along the edge, in particular, where,
you know, the rows have been reduced. In this case, this entire row here has gone away. Same as at the top, this entire row has gone away. As you move down, there are some areas that it's even more substantial. Anywhere that there were really short sections of rows,
it's just not practical in the applicant's view, from the applicant's perspective, and obviously they, you know, they have it in their interest to try to have this project be what they could, but it just, from a construction standpoint, looking at it with the current applicant, this reduced footprint is what they're.
It just seems to me you're giving up a lot of revenue, but that's not my problem.
I was going to say, some questions outside of the domain of this discussion, but everything that you're looking to do here with reduction, I don't think
you need. I agree with Fran.
I was kind of hoping there'd be more powerful solar panels by now. So.
Well, I was wondering if the technology has gotten better. There's questions outside of what can you do.
Understood. And our letter dated January 4th, we tried to just itemize all the changes that have been made here for the board's ease in understanding this. And again, we respectfully request issuance of modification.
And to make it clear that there would be no change in any of the conditions that we previously approved?
Understood.
The screening changes because the fence changes, particularly if you look at
C2.2.
This piece, you lose a lot of the stuff that was right down in there, which is the area that I think the board members had the most trouble with because of the visibility from the side.
All these short sections of arrays have gone away, and between
the 29 plantings that were proposed to screen that area specifically, that's the only change to the landscaping that was done. Even though we've reduced impacts in the buffer zone and to the wetlands, all the wetland plantings are still as previously proposed as well.
The screening that just shoots off around the corner. You've gotten rid of that long stretch, but introduced the short stretch.
And we've curled it around to provide that same intent for screening.
Just refreshing my memory, where's the 135?
Down below.
Along the
down one more sheet. That there's 135.
Okay,
and you can see the dark roadway where they connect.
So that small strip that comes up close to the road is going to be eliminated. So
yes.
We have one question on the increase of fence height from 6 to 10 feet where the deer was jumping up.
That it's construction level detail. The associate that had presented this to you previously, that's something that I picked up on at taking over the project at this point to bring it to construction level, that 7 foot is specifically to preclude deer from jumping in and causing havoc inside.
And Elaine, you have the full set? Because I think in our package we just got the changes.
There is a full set of plans. Same set. It's a revision to the previous set. We've added these three sheets, C2.1 to 2.3.
So you have what you need to write a decision. Okay. I think, any questions from the public? Tim?
Back up off the site. There's a line that goes through that pond. I'm just wondering what that was.
Go back to C2.1. We just want to go back to C2.1. There we go.
You have that's it.
That one or C2.1?
No. No, that's a wooded area. The pond was on C2.2.
That's the upper corner next to
C22 shows the pond, yeah.
This is the pond. Pulling
those off and landing for spectacular. Okay.
That's one word.
Yeah.
Very helpful.
Okay. I think we're ready. I've entertained a motion to approve, first of all, to find that this is a minor change, and that we approve the modifications to the special permit and the stormwater management permit, subject to all the same conditions that were in the original permit.
Second.
Second. Elaine, is that motion good enough?
It is.
Okay. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
Thank you very much for your time.
You're welcome. When are you going to start construction?
The plan would be very early spring, so within...
You still need approvals from the utility?
The company, that is the critical path item at this point.
Okay.
We got the gate, the fence to keep up
here. Where are the sheep made? Where are the
fence? What, the goats?
They have the road access. That dark thing is a road to get into. They drive them in a truck. They take them out. Yeah.
Some part of that.
One other question. The top part, the panels are closer together. Is that because you're on a hill?
Correct. Due to the slope.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, we've got a few items we want to get done yet. Elaine submitted an annual report in our package, if I can find where it is. I thought I had a comment to it. Oh, here it is. I would suggest that we add, kind of at the bottom of it, something like, kind of thank some people that worked on stuff, and thanking Mrs. Thomas for her service when she left the board. And something like, the board also thanks members of the public for their input at our many public hearings. Your input is very valuable for the members in reaching our decisions. Just to be kind of courteous. And
will you give that to us in writing?
Yes. If you can read it, that's great. But you'll get the idea. Other than that, I think I didn't see anything factually that I couldn't remember that was there. What? So that should be off the list, right?
No, that was the, you issued the special permit.
For the flexible. Yep. Okay. Hey, geez, you're questioning Elaine again. Okay. Members ready to recommend? This has to be submitted soon, right? Or sometime around now. Are people ready to submit the draft? Look for a motion to submit the annual report.
Second.
Seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. Let's get to the last couple things really quickly here. Minutes for the 21st. Does anyone have any comments on December 21st? Seeing no comments, I would entertain a motion to approve the minutes of December 22nd, 2015.
21st approved.
21st. Moved and seconded. Okay, I think we're ready for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, Boroughs Economic and Development Summit. Elaine, refresh me on that one.
It's an event being held Tuesday, looks like January 26th, at 7:30 in the morning, and board members are invited to attend.
Okay.
Lieutenant Governor Karen Polito will be there, and the moderator will be Barry Bluestone, talking about specifically the Marlboro area, and Hopkinton's included in that area, talking about economic development issues and commonalities and those kinds of things for the towns in that immediate area. So it's a tightly focused regional area. It should be very interesting and informative. Jennifer Burke in our office has been involved in the planning of the event, is working with that group.
Yeah.
So same entity. Yeah.
And then we're going to do another one and it kind of never happened.
Well, this is it. Yeah.
That's probably a good one. There's also in Brockton a lighting.
A workshop.
Workshop during a long day, if I remember right, or many hours, including lunch. Okay. I'm trying to remember which ones I've signed up for, but I might go along on that one just because we struggle with lighting. Any other correspondence that we need to be
aware? Nope. That's it.
Anything that people want on the agenda, of course, give me a call and we'll get it on the agenda, though we're getting kind of packed and with the legacy bit. Zach is just about finishing up on a lot of things, I believe, and they're doing well. And Claire?
I just want to ask a question on the lighting. Like to this issue where the flood light picked up, that showed up, I've seen it happen a lot around town. There are sites that are approved, and then after the fact, they go and stick these floodlights in, which are in violation of our bylaws. The Manager's Building has a couple on the back.
Like the Town Hall.
It's got a bunch of nobody sitting out the patio, can't hide, like, 19 degrees. How do we go about, once they're up here approved, how do we go back and address these things that stuff like that in the past?
If it's brought to the attention of the enforcement officials, they'll go out and they'll enforce that.
For example, I drove by the telephone exchange, and I thought, geez, those arborvitaes are a little short. Now, I drove by kind of fast, and Lane takes a walk with a bunch of town employees, and I said, next time, go over there and see if they're short. And I guess most of them are, and I guess they're going to get fixed in the spring.
So do you think that we should bring this to the attention of the building inspectors individually or ask the board to take one up and compare it to
them? As an individual citizen.
I can pass them along as well, though, if you send me addresses.
I hear we're black and white in our colors.
As I said earlier, it's a test.
Well, some of us look better in black and white.
Good night, Frankie and Lucy. I love you.
Watching? Did you watch?
I watched right now.
Oh, okay.
They're concerned with this black and white.
The motion on the table to adjourn. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? I hope not. Meeting's adjourned.